so much for being here. I really
appreciate
you taking the time. Like, this week's been a little crazy with everything going on in the world, so I appreciate you taking the time to be here.
Yeah, but I appreciate you too. Appreciate you as well. Appreciate you for having me as well.
Oh, thank you. So we've never actually met in person. I know you through, we have a mutual friend, Ben, who's the producer of this podcast.
Yeah,
and he's just told me so much about your story, and I just knew I had to have you on because this podcast is all about inspiration, and everything that he told me about you, you are such an inspiration. So I would just love for you to tell everybody your story. I know a little bit about it, but I would just love to hear it from your mouth. So I know you, first of all, like, you know, you lost your parents young, and you had to you know, support your family. So I would just love for you to start from the beginning and tell your
story. All right, cool. So I'm not gonna give you the long version. I'll brief everything, but I'll make sure I cover everything. At ninth grade, I met my friend, my best friend. And that best friend turned into my girlfriend. A girlfriend turned into a soon-to-be mother of my child, my boy. So I'm 16 years old. She's 17 years old. And we have a child on the way. So at that point, I'm in the sports. I'm doing great in school. However, I'm in a neighborhood in the city of Philadelphia where I'm walking past certain things that are intriguing to me. I grew up, I had both of my parents in the household, so it wasn't like I had a broken home, but it was like there was things in terms of like cars, jewelry. I just seen a lot of things, money. And I decided to take the wrong route. And I was on that road for 10 years. So I started to sell drugs at 16 years old. So it wasn't until 10 years afterwards that I realized the importance of planting seeds, whether they be negative or positive, and the things that come out of those seeds that we plant every single day, and being intentional with our purpose. So, you know, I'm selling drugs, and it wasn't until I was 20 years old, a childhood friend of mine who had owed me some money decided instead of to pay me, he was, you know, try to murder me. So him and his friend shot my car up 15 times. I was sitting in the driver's seat, and I was shot in my back, and I was shot in my hamstring. I still have the bullet in my back where my spine is at.
Really? I didn't know that. Oh, Ben left that detail out. That's crazy.
Yes.
Gosh.
So, you know, some things occurred. A month later, I heal up, and yeah, this neighborhood that I was from, man, it was bad. So guys that were in this other neighborhood that I had an apartment at thought that they were going to come in the apartment and rob me. I was shot once again. So twice in one summer, I'm 19 years old, still young, on the wrong path, of course. My mother works for the post office. My father is a lieutenant at a prison. So I'm hiding the stuff that I'm doing in the street. I'm still going to school. I'm going back and forth. But once I get shot, they're like, yo, what's going on, Lewis? So I can see that my parents never gave up on me. They're always like, look, Lewis, you can do so much more. You can do so much more. Your son needs you. Your family needs you. We need you. We love you. A year later, my mother calls me and she asks me to meet her at the hospital. My father, who taught me how to be a man, was in the Marine Corps. He was a boxer. He taught me how to be emotional, taught me how to love my sisters, love my brother, you know, respect my mother. He was my king. I get to the hospital and my mom's crying over the bed and he passed away. He died of asphyxiation at the age of 41. He was a health nut, so he woke up choking on the food he had the night before. So I'm 20, my mother, I got my three younger sisters. 4 years later, the worst thing that could ever happen, my sister calls me on her birthday, it's 11-year-old birthday. They're in church. My mother testifies, if God takes me today or tomorrow, I'm ready. And she had a heart attack in church. Yeah. She died at the age of 45.
So young, both of your parents, so young.
So now I'm 24 years old at the time. I have two children of my own, and I have my three younger sisters. So now my job is to go out into the waiting room. I don't have any time to mourn or, you know, really get into my own feelings, because I have to go into the waiting room and tell my sister, who's, it's her birthday, 11-year-old birthday, my 16-year-old sister and my 9-year-old sister, that they have to now come live with me. Good thing is we had a home. We had got a home. My children's mother, she had great credit. So now we have five children. I'm 24, she's 25. We have my three younger sisters. We have my son and my daughter, but it's love in the household. It's a ton of love. And we're going to make it through this together. So that's when I really started understanding the importance of, like, being present, because I had ran so much that I looked up and now my mother and father are both gone, 45 and 41, and I can no longer have that conversation with them or get the advice on which way I should go. But, you know, karma starts to kick in. So you can sell drugs for as long as you want, but eventually it ends up in either death or jail. And luckily for me, the best thing that happened for me was I was given a 4 to 10 year prison sentence. So during that four to 10 year prison sentence, I got into a fight in prison and I was given 6 months solitary confinement. That's where I'm in a cell for 23 hours every single day and you get out for an hour. So you're in a small box, a very small box. And then you get a 15-minute shower, 15-minute phone call, and then you get to walk outside in a cage inside of a huge field. So
you're giving me anxiety just thinking about it.
This is 180 days that I have to do. It's prison within the prison. So it's like, it's the place where they just send anybody who has had any confrontations, who's gotten in a fight, stabbings, it's all types of crazy stuff. Long story short, during that time, my first 2 months, it felt like the walls were closing in and it was extremely challenging. But it wasn't until I sat down and really, like, hit rock bottom. Like, I'm talking about, like extreme depression. I was angry. I punched on the walls. I was just upset. I was mad, but I didn't have anyone to be upset with but myself. And when I realized that, you know, the seeds that I were planting had led me to where I was today, I was like, damn, how do I reverse that? How do I reverse that karma? How do I just, you know, take responsibility for where I'm at and then set this trajectory to a whole nother path? Because it started at 16 where I went left. Yeah, man. And that's when, like, the world just opened up, because, you know, I accepted where I was at, responsibility for being there. And I said, you know what, I'm going to treat this 4 years as if it's college. So I started to get my family to send me up all types of books on the anatomy, nutrition, like anything you could think about, the laws of nature, the laws of the universe, anything you could think about with regards to personal development and also physical fitness. Because I was like, all right, I have a felony, but once I leave this place, I can become, I know how to run an operation. So that's the thing that I did learn. Mm-hmm. So it's like, I can still be an entrepreneur, but I can then plant positive seeds and also be proud about sharing this with my son, my daughter, and my sisters, letting them know this is what I'm doing with my life. I haven't given up. So I got multiple certifications while in prison, and it was just amazing. 4 years went past. It's time to see the parole board. It's time for me to leave and become a free man. And the parole board says, listen, the judge is recommending that you do the entire 10 years. So go back to your cell and we'll review your case in another year. So now 4 years turns into 5 years. But the mindset, that's why, you know, I came up with this concept while in prison, that warrior's mindset is just like understanding that no matter how long it takes along this journey, once you're locked in and focused, it's like anything can happen. So I'm like, all right, I have another year. Let me treat this year to, like, really tap into my mind and my spirit and, you know, really set my intention, write down more goals, figure out how I'm going to do with the LLC and taxes. Like, I was reading anything and everything you could think of, because I'm like, I gotta escape the streets. It's a dark hole and it steals your spirit. And luckily it was just like, I knew that I had something else to offer. So, fifth year I was given parole, and that was around the end of 2014. And, like, since then, man, I've been trading, like, police officers, judges, trained like firefighters. I've had like so many different transformations. My daughter now has her own LLC. She has her own business. She's 16. She has a pastry company. Her Instagram is Made by My Joy. So you can check her stuff out. My son is doing 4X and he's writing children's books. My oldest sister, she has a master's and she has three children. My sister, who my mom passed on her birthday, has her own house, and my youngest sister lives with her, and they both have good jobs. Actually, my 11-year-old sister now works at the job that my mom worked at before she passed away. So it was just like all of these different blessings, and every day I wake up and I'm like, all right, it's not just about personal training. It's like I go speak to the youth. I have different things going on in Philadelphia where it's just like community-based. Now my job is to like really plant those seeds and like touch that one person that's thinking about, damn, I got to go to the streets to be able to take care of my family. It's like so many other opportunities. So I want to give a plug to NOMO, New Options, More Opportunities. That's a company in Philadelphia that I deal with, and we're giving back to this, to the community. Long story short, I've been out since the end of 2014, and I've just been able to accomplish a lot of things. And I say, you know what? Philly is behind me. Let me move to LA and like build even more. And this is where I met Ben. And eventually I want to be able to transition my family out here as well. And we'll just leave Philly in our rearview mirror.
Wow. Oh my gosh. Lewis, I don't even know where to start because your story is amazing. I love it because you could have easily made yourself either a victim or completely given up. I mean, you had so much negative things happen to you at such a early age. And I feel like that's something you're born with, right? Where it's, yes, it's like, you know, people either become a victim. Oh, my dad died. My mom died. I, you know, had kids really young. You know, I can't do anything about it, you know, like I got shot, like every, you know, you had like the craziest things happen to you. If one of those things, just one of those things happened to the average person, I don't know how they would handle it. And you've done, like, you've been through hell and back, and you have made the absolute best out of it. And
thank you.
There's definitely a reason you're here, 100%. Yes. Someone gets dealt all of that shot and go to prison. And then to be in that small room, I mean, now everyone's seeing just in COVID, just staying in your homes, everyone is seeing how hard that is. You were in this tiny little room. Did you have a window at least at all?
And I want to be honest about this. When you talk about prison, it's not set up for rehabilitation. It's set up for recidivism. I mean, it's privatized. That's just a part of the system. And when I realized it, I was like, wow, I'm just a number. And it's set up for me to be here. And not only be here, because now the college courses were all taken out of the prisons as well. So if I'm sitting here for years, I can't get a college degree. But what I can do is invest my own money to have books sent up so I can teach myself. Mm-hmm. So to answer your question with regards to the window, the way that the cell is set up, is set up to psychologically break you down. Mm-hmm. So they have a window. I want to say it's every bit of the size of, let's just picture a 17-inch, let's say 34 inches, 36 inches, a yard. Mm-hmm. But the width is, I want to say, maybe 4 inches wide. And it's in the corner where the wall meets so that you can't put your head in to see outside, but you can see the glare of the sun come through. So it's dark in the cell. You have a slab of metal that you lay on. You have a stainless steel sink. You have a stainless steel toilet. You have a mirror. But the challenge with the mirror is so many guys have been in there that they carve their, you know, gang names and different street names on there. So you can't even see your reflection.
Oh my God.
So yeah, I had to do 180 days. And it's every single day, the most challenging thing was just to be centered and just like, okay, my body is here, but my mind and my spirit is elsewhere. So I did a lot of meditation. I did a lot of reading. I did a lot of like, the first month of it, I was like just frustrated because I was angry. But after that subsided and I realized that, okay, this isn't the end. It was like, all right, what do I do with this time? Mm-hmm. And once I realized that, you know, this training and physical fitness and the anatomy and nutrition and to be able to transform lives and train individuals, not no longer sell them a bag of heroin or a bag of crack, to actually train them and help them, you know, get off of these diabetes pills and help them with depression, help them get off of, you know, this high blood pressure pills. I'm like, I can reverse my karma. So it was just all about like just doing the right thing and actually feeling pure, like feeling good in my heart about what I was doing. So that got me through it. But to be honest with you, it's a lot of individuals that go crazy in there, like literally.
Yeah, it takes a very, I couldn't even imagine. It takes a very strong person to not break down. Like you said, they designed it to break you down. And it's horrible. It's absolutely horrible. So I don't know. I mean, you're amazing. I don't even know what to say. Thank you, Morgan. Where do you think that your love for fitness came from and wanting to, you know, help people? Like, where did that come from when you're in there and you're trying to figure out what you're going to do to better your life when you get out? Why did fitness come to your mind? Were you always into fitness, or was this like, did you get this in prison? You started.
Well, I was always into fitness because, well, I wasn't always into fitness. I was always into physical activity because my father was in the Marines and he also boxed. And he did the Broad Street runs in Philadelphia. It's like one of the biggest streets. He did marathons and stuff like that. So he would always have me doing calisthenics. He would have me doing a lot of bodyweight stuff, running. We would play basketball together. He really like taught me how to be a man. And the thing that was most important was when we were younger, my brother and I, you know, my father would hug us and we looked at him as this strong man, but he would also show us like, I want y'all to always have each other's back. So he would shed tears and let us know, like, I really love y'all. Mm-hmm. So it showed me this thing where it's just like, we got this strong man right here, but you can all, he's also allowing you to be, to express yourself emotionally.
Vulnerable, yeah.
Exactly. So when he passed away and, you know, he died of asphyxiation off of a health drink, he would always say, you know, health is wealth. He would always say, you know, we have to take care of our bodies. He gave us herbs when we were young. And my mom died of a heart attack at 45. So even before prison, I was just like, this is crazy. Like, we have to take care of our bodies. Not to say that they didn't take care of their bodies, but it's like, whatever I invest in myself, that's what I'm going to get out. So when I sat in prison and I felt, you know, the first month, honestly, I felt, you know, what depression really, really felt like. I was just so frustrated. And I started to like get headaches and everything because I was just angry. I'm just like, I don't know what to do. I sat down and was just like, you know what? Let me just start really just focusing on the
and
mind.
It's not even about the struggling. Body. So like, luckily, let me start, I left, you know, at a really good time.
Positive affirmations.
Where I was already kind of established.
Having that internal
dialogue. Loyal.
Where I can personally, loyal. Yeah, and I had loyal clients who stayed with me.
You know, I started
Zoom.
Believing my own hype.
It's just, scary like, for so many small businesses.
Alter ego that
you know, you remember my friend Aurelio. You and I and him did a comedy sketch together years ago.
Oh my gosh, yes.
You know what?
He's a personal trainer. He's been working for a while. It affected his business. It's been tough. And the thing is with the Zoom with you, where you're so lucky is it makes sense for you to be able to train somebody via Zoom. Stand-up comedy doesn't work.
Well, you know what? Yes, I agree. However, I have a couple of a couple of my friends at Equinox who are trainers are also comedians. And they did a Zoom comedy show that I attended. They had everyone pay them like over Venmo. I think it was like $5 for the show. There was probably like 30 people on the Zoom call.
Was it that Nowhere Comedy Club?
Wow.
Yeah, 175 to 225.
There's a couple of them.
My friend Chris just kind of like put it on just himself.
Where my spine
I think they're all just starting out. You know, and so they and they do like open mics and stuff. And so they did this Zoom comedy show, and I thought, you know, me
teach people
being in that world for so long, I'm like, this is gonna be a disaster. It's actually a lot of fun.
I've been able now, to, like, comic performing, were they like how I am now, or were they on a stage?
No, like, they were like just sitting there.
You put that energy out there. You put that those vibrations, out that jokes. Positive energy out there.
Like they were just trauma material they've been writing, and they were kind of playing off each other. So what they did was they had muted everybody in the audience, and then all the comics had their mics on. So it wasn't just necessarily one of them going up and then the next. Like it was sort of like that, but they were kind of playing off each other, and it just made it really funny. You know how Zoom when somebody. So talking, it'll go to their screen, and then it'll go to the next person talking. So it was going back and forth, like, and it actually ended up about working really well. But
experiences,
I also had very low expectations.
That's new. So maybe
yeah, I can't do it. It's not stand up. It's not live comedy.
People end up.
And I've been asked to do a lot. There are a few people that are putting on these really interesting shows where it's actually a stage, microphone, and then they're surrounded by the screens, like an audience.
People
that movie Minority Report. There's just all kinds of shit happening at the same time.
And so they don't.
And that looks interesting, but like, alone.
So yes. I mean,
there's other other alternatives that people have been hitting, like drive-in shows. I don't want to be telling my stand-up and then have.
I'm not alone.
Because the way they're applauding is they're honking their horns and flashing their lights.
And look what they did with it.
Nah, I'll wait.
It's so weird.
And nothing against the people that are doing that.
You know, doing my life. Like,
but yeah, it's just nothing is like a just worse normal
done to you than I've normal ever heard. And you've overcome it.
I just want to be normal again.
I just want to be a normal person.
You know, so I was thinking when I decided to have you on as my first guest. Let's just say this here. Again. My first guest to my first podcast.
And what are we calling the podcast?
More Games with Morgan. Get it?
Have people punch
I like
you
that.
Like it?
More Games with Morgan.
Yeah, so I thought it made sense. Like, what does that because mean? Because I, physically, you know, like, obviously the... I mean, well, maybe not obviously, but the reason I wanted to do this podcast was to get people like you that really inspire me. I see where you have come from. I see how far you've come. And so it's inspiring to me. And I want, as a trainer, I try to be inspiring to people that want to get fit and healthy. But I also am huge into, you know, following your dreams and doing what you want to do. Maybe it's not the easiest road, but it'll be worth it. And so I like to have people on like you to inspire others to go after what they want to do. So with that said, I thought I wanted you on because as long as I've known you, I have no idea why you actually got into comedy. I know that you were into martial arts before and you had a family and you started a lot older than most comics, but I have no idea what got you into it, which is so weird. We never had that conversation. So I'd love to hear your story of, like, I know you have a twin brother who I'm also very close to, and yeah, so I have no idea though how you guys grew up and what got you to where you are today. So
I grew up in the entertainment
train as if your life depends on
kind of. Okay, so when I was before I was born and when I was very young, my father was in the music industry.
To like how I trained.
My dad had a hit single in the 1970s. Okay, I'm toured it. He was on television. Did American Bandstand with Dick Clark and all that stuff.
Wow.
Yeah, he actually. You listen or watch? You watch my podcast?
Yeah.
The theme song in the beginning.
Yeah.
That's my dad's hit.
I just trained
for combat.
That's my dad's
single.
71.
So there were different techniques that I learned.
Yeah.
Not just
but yeah, like, we got, so my dad's kind of involved in the podcast. But like, so I grew up there, and I was because I always had the entertainment bug.
I just read, so I studied martial arts.
But I was pretty insecure kid, like shy. I knew that I had talent, but I started off doing music. Like I was singing and producing music when I was a kid.
With your whole entire
and then I ended up getting a record deal to produce hip hop music in like 1990, maybe 89, 90. Had a few little successes with that, and then signed a bad contract, and it went away. And then I had my second. I had kids really young needed to put food on the table. So at 21 years old, I opened a martial arts school because I'd been studying martial arts all my life before that. And my brother was a black belt. My brother was already teaching
at
schools. And my father had just gotten his black belt. And so the three of us said, let's
and his whole training.
My dad was unhappy at work, and he wanted to do something else. And so we
with nothing but
he called. I worked at the company that my dad was vice president of. And I was working in the production department, and he was vice president of the company.
His body is also just amazing what it can do.
Hold on, they found me.
So I feel like there
is. I live down the street from a hospital, so every once in a while they he called me into his office one day. He says, "I don't want to do this anymore." I go, "What?" I mean, he's vice president of a Fortune 500.
And so every time I visit,
he helped build from the ground up.
You can see the.
And it was like my first real job, and at his company, and I had just bought a car, you know.
Morgan, it's the,
and I'm glad he says, honestly, I don't want to do this anymore.
Once I found something,
what's going on?
Like, I'm like, yo.
So, well, they're laying people off.
Not only like good at this, I'm great at this.
This was at the company, and I go, okay. And my, like I sort of said, he was the VP of the company, like, but he wasn't like the boss.
Being able to tap,
he had a boss, and then there was an owner. So he had like two
thoughts, your speech, and your action. Like, even if they're gonna make me lay people off, thing or the thing that gets a lot of likes, a lot of followers. Like, that was never my goal.
And they are putting you at the top.
Just lead with your truth.
They're going to make me lay off my
own side. I am and what I'm made of. While in solitary confinement,
it was like the worst. And he was literally like, "F this place."
I found Lewis.
Let's. And then once he goes down to this, you're a black belt. What you see on Instagram. You're winning competitions.
I'm just always.
I got my black belt. Excited. I got business.
Like my mind is my pre-workout. I'm just
brother. Got amazing teaching experience. Let's open our own school.
And I could not be here.
This is kind of this is the kind of guy my dad was.
Any legs at all.
He said, "Let's open our own school."
Every single day is.
I'm telling you honestly, 30 days to the day after that meeting in his office, we had our grand opening of
positive individuals, and also like
we secured funding, found a location, built it, and opened the school 30 days later.
Oh,
we deal with all types of.
So we had our grand opening of our school in 1992, and then I just did that. That's literally all I did. I built that individual. School with my family, it kept,
please don't give up.
Got me cars, it got me a house, it got me everything I needed and wanted for my kids. And
so, yeah, so that's
but I was always in the back of my mind. I'm like, this is not what I want to do. It was my dad's dream.
I just came back from Philadelphia.
I was helping him live his dream of having a family business.
Not on a large level yet.
Being in business with his son. It was beautiful.
On my Instagram. So I'm planting that seed. And I know and, for a fact that
then
it's
going to
come.
You know,
all a process.
At like 35 years. I opened at 21.
Yes.
And then at 35 years old, my body started like telling me, yo, stop competing. Stop doing it. Because I was really into like heavily into full contact kind of karate fighting. I was into MMA, Brazilian jiu-jitsu.
Like where you were,
my body was taking out. Maybe beating.
They're,
and my kids were still
injury,
young, you know, and I didn't want to not be able
drugs,
to
maybe
hang with my
you know,
kids.
Wherever.
And,
and they want to
entertainment bug in the back of my mind. Like, I want to do this thing.
Say,
meanwhile,
so
I met and became really good friends with a little-known comedian named Joe Coy.
Solitary confinement helped me realize.
And Joe Coy and I met and became pretty good fast friends. Like we immediately
move and we're dictated.
And I just started going with him to all of his shows.
The advice would be
and before that, I had already always taught. With humor,
outside noise,
I knew how to command a room full of people and keep their attention for an hour or more. And I did most of that with humor. Even though I'm teaching martial arts, I'm making them laugh. I'm making them have a good time. The kids that I used to teach are having a blast, but I'm able to still keep it disciplined. So I had that. I was working that muscle with commanding an audience. But I
have to.
I love stand-up. Like all growing up, like the big events in my house, like when the next George Carlin special was coming on, we would all get in front of it. It was like sports for some
family.
Dad really loved stand-up. It was like the thing in my house. So then I got became friends with an actual stand-up comedian, which I was like, what? Then I started hanging out with Joe Coy at all his shows, and I wanted to. I told him I want to do this. I really want to do this. Let's do it. And around that time,
this right here, I'm just doing.
My father had been diagnosed with cancer,
and I know for a fact this isn't
right.
taking me where
and
I need
he,
to go. So once I realized I wanted,
he got diagnosed.
I wanted to get
like,
better. I want to be done with the streets. I had to
around. I think I was around 31.
Sometimes when I come out of prison, I might not have any like, of the money that I had
when went into remission for four years. Like, he battled it for 4 years.
I had the love great. Of my
like,
children.
He was great.
The love of my children's mom.
But then it came back, and it was like from one of those things where, like, he's not going to survive.
Look at me,
he's
like, yo, he has a lot of, that doesn't matter.
And meanwhile, I'm telling Joe every time we're out, I'm like, man, I really want to do this. I really want to do this, right? He's like, yo, you should. And then he would introduce me to people like, those Jason Collins. He's a martial arts instructor, but he's like an aspiring comedian. He wants to try comedy. And, you know, when you're in comedy, you look at those guys are going, mask, whatever.
You attract imposters. Yeah. You attract
like, okay, sure, so you like do. You know? Because it's like you either do it or you don't.
Yeah, you either do it full time or you don't do it.
Right.
Yeah.
That's it. And that's one day,
yes,
Joe Coy had a show. He was headlining. No, he wasn't headlining. He was featuring for John Lovitz.
And I know you're going to do
Frasier Smith was hosting. Joe was featuring. Lovitz was headlining in Brea at the Improv in Brea. And he said, you want to go with me? And I was like, yeah. He goes, cool. I'll stop by and I'll pick you up. Now, mind you, at the time, my dad was dealing with cancer, so I was spending a lot of time at his house with him. And I told Joe, I go, if you don't mind, because he knew that where I Long Beach was on the way to Brea from where he was. I said, can you pick me up at my dad's house? He's like, yeah, I'll pick you up at your dad's house. Just give me the address. And I'm like, cool. So he shows up at my parents' house, and my dad really wanted to meet him. Because being an ex-entertainer, he loved meeting other successful entertainers. So then Joe comes in, and I'm getting ready. I go, hey, I'll be right there. I'm going to get ready. And then I left the room, and Joe sat in the room with my dad and had a conversation that I, to this day, I don't know how the conversation went. All I know is that when we got in the car, Joe was serious. And he said, before we backed out of the driveway, he said, dude, do you really want to do stand-up?
Gonna make it.
I said, yeah, dude, I tell you that all the time. Of course I want to do it. He goes, no.
Come say your goodbye.
Do you really want to do it?
How old are you?
I was like,
I was 8.
This is different.
Wow.
In my head, I go, yeah, I really, really want
to
do it.
My parents were told to.
He says, and excuse my language, he says, then stop being such a pussy about it and do it. Or your father may not be able to see you do it.
My cousins and my grandpa.
And that was like, so I never thought of it that way.
The driver,
I'm telling you, the next day,
off the road, and my grandpa didn't have time.
I wrote. Tried writing down jokes, which is not my, to this day, that's not my process.
Threw the car and started beating him.
I couldn't really write anything, but I could think of funny things. So I said to my brother, I'm just going to wing it. I went to the Ha Ha Cafe is where I met you.
Yeah, they said.
And I'm telling you, when you and I met, it was right around this time when this was happening. Like, I was brand new.
You know, she's toxins all over her body.
So I went to the Ha Ha and I asked for the owner of it. I didn't know how it worked. You have to understand, I didn't understand that there was an open mic system. I didn't understand any of that because my experience with comedy was hanging out with a headliner at like A-list clubs. I thought that was comedy. I thought, like, I'm going to do jokes now, so let me go on at the Laugh Factory. That's how I thought it worked.
Had that
didn't
for
know
a year,
any of the rules.
And then they went back and
then Joe told me you got to go to this place called the Ha Ha Cafe. So I went.
Said, we've never done this.
Asked
before.
For the owner.
We don't know how long she's gonna have. But
I think that's how
alive.
It worked.
It's cool.
And then you to talk to the owner and tell him I'm doing comedy here. So I asked for the owner, and he comes out, and he's like, can I help you? I go, yeah, I'm a friend of Joe Coy's and John Lovitz and Frasier Smith. I dropped their names.
All these different things.
Goes, oh, okay. I go, they told me to come here. He goes, oh, they told you to come here? I go, yeah. I go, I'm a comedian. Never did a comedy. He goes, oh, you're a comedian? I go, yeah. Joe and John Lovitz and Frasier, hold on. No, told you right down the street from hospital.
You're still searching.
You have things to do. Yeah. I remember thinking that
I said those names like, told me to come here and that I could do comedy
so
here.
That I remembered this.
This is how I got into comedy. And Jack goes, how long have you been doing stand-up? I said, 5 years. That's the number that came out of my mouth. And if you know, you do know enough about it that a 5-year comic is, he's got his act down, he's good. A lot of times they're already featuring. So I said, I've been doing stand-up for 5 years. Really? Where? I go, you know, down in Orange County, some places around here.
I was dyslexic, so I was really behind. I hated school.
He said,
and
Joe,
I never got to catch up.
Yeah.
He never held me back.
All right, come back tomorrow. I'll put you on the show.
So lost.
Not the open mic. Not the weekday show.
When I came back, I also went from a private school to a public school.
So I show up the next day to the show. And I walk in and I... And
so
this
is
so crazy.
Tough.
I walk
up, you know,
and the guy at the podium
bit,
checking comics
active
in was Chris D'Elia.
My situation.
Oh, yeah.
And
He's like, what's your name? I go, I'm Jason Collins. I forgot on the show. He goes, really, oh yeah, Jason. What's up, dude? I'm Chris. I'm like, how you doing, man? And I'm like, good to meet you. And then we go inside, and then we ended up sitting together. Well, no, here's what happened.
Boyfriend.
I end up walking in, and the guy running the show comes up and he goes, are you Jason Collins? I go, yeah. He goes, okay, you're going on third, and you're doing 15 minutes. I'll light you at
for a long time 12 minutes. And I was just scared because like, he was threatening to kill me or kill my family.
I have no idea what he's talking about.
And I believed him because he was so scary. He was older than me.
Light me? I did not know what that was. So but I didn't want people to know. I didn't know what the hell I was doing. That thing that you said.
Had enough and cool. Got, I mean,
he, and then I didn't know
the worst thing that got is he
15 minute set is an awesome set. Most people when they start they're working on their 3 minute
pulled me out, 5 minute threw me out in front of
15 minutes is a long time.
It got really
long.
I didn't think that because I've every day during the day I'm teaching 1 hour plus classes and trying to keep hundreds and hundreds of people interested in what I'm doing for an hour.
So 15 minutes is nothing. I also kind of developed a drinking problem.
And I didn't write any jokes. So I'm like, I'm just going to wing it like I do at work.
I didn't want to tell anybody what was going on with me.
The time comes for me to go on stage. They introduce me. I go up. Because I have a great set. I literally sat on the stool. And, I did crowd work. I did everything you do in comedy. Really I did that and so literally on my first set.
I would
say
that was probably my lowest. Callbacks, I would go to work at 17.
Took the mic out of the mic stand, moved the mic stand like you're supposed to. Because you know a lot of new comics, they leave the mic stand right in front of them.
It was really bad. I just
And then I see the guy running the show. He's got his flip phone open and he's waving it at me.
Said, you know what, we've
and I'm
had
like,
enough.
What the hell is he like, doing? I didn't know what that was, why he was doing it. I'm like, do I have a phone call? Like, what's happening?
So I'm 17.
Then I realized, that's what he meant by like the light. My time's up. So that wrapped it up, and I said goodnight, and I got off stage. And
stayed sober. It was big really applause. Bad. And when, that was like,
and then the host went, what do you think of Jason Collins? This is his first time here, and big applause. Jack comes up and he goes, come back tomorrow, you're on the show.
Throw up in my hair. Amazing. I had just gotten fired.
During that
doesn't happen, by the way.
It never happened. And don't think anybody listening to this, don't think that that's how it's going to go for you because it ain't.
Never.
But while I was on stage, I hear this maniacal laugh.
I'm better than this. There's a reason God said
horribly loud,
you know, this accident.
Awful laugh. That almost sounds like a fake laugh and that I'm being made fun of.
So I got a restraining order on that boyfriend. That was Chris.
Yeah. We all know his laugh. Holy shit. And when I got off stage, he's like, oh my God, dude, that was so funny, man. I go, he's like, how long have you been doing this? And I go, honestly, what time is it?
He goes,
he tells me the time. I go, 15 minutes is how long I've been doing this. He's like, he had only been doing it for like 6 months.
Like, another part of it is.
And then when he went on stage after me, and then I was laughing in the back, and then we hung out after, and that's how we became best friends, and we did everything together. Brent Morin showed up a few months later and joined the crew, and
that ended up not working.
So you know what's so funny about this whole story is while you're telling the story of you.
Because I had worked so
at the
hard
same time, so probably around the same time that this, that was happening,
in my mid-20s at this
point, I completely lied to Jay about photography. Kind of, so okay, I'm like, working as yeah, much. So I'll like got into you. Photography. I go to this nice interview with this photographer, Michael Senville, that I wanted to work with. I want to intern with him.
He had the control.
And on the way back from the meeting, I had a friend with me. It's my, I'm 18. It's my first time in Hollywood. And
house,
we see this like
money.
Line wrapped around
but at
the
that
corner
point,
for,
had developed
the Chinese theater
somehow.
So my friend's like, well, let's see what's going on.
Said,
so
you know
we go
what?
Up
I've been
and
a lot.
You know, I asked
I
somebody,
can,
like,
I'll
what are
you
guys setting in life for? And they said, the employee of the month
and
premiere
so I
with Dane Cook and Jesse Simpson. So
back to California and that's when I
yes, and
in that relationship he had.
Has one
of
my favorite
kind of tore
podcasts.
Me down a bit
my favorite,
like,
yeah, other
you
than yours,
thighs.
Of course.
You, I don't like my look, and then he peed
yeah.
on me,
so
I told myself,
so
at
we
that
go
point,
ask the security guard, he's like, we have to have a ticket,
and
I'm
mentally,
like, oh,
physically.
I'm not gonna
and so for the first time in my life, I started working like, out in my mid-20s.
All right, all right, all right, everyone, single file line, and he pushes my friend and I in the line, lets everyone in, like a movie,
just learning
cuts off
and then
after my friend and I. I and says, I'm sorry, that's all the room we have. Thanks for showing up. And I felt, I couldn't even look at the person behind me. I felt so guilty.
Probably bought a ticket, right?
Oh, yeah, they got tickets. I mean, I guess they were free, but you had to print them out and then stand in line. So I get in, and then I see Dane Cook. I was a huge, he was big at the time, and I was a fan, so I go up and I talked to him. He couldn't care less, but Jay Davis was next to him, and he's like, you know, he introduced me to Jay. And he's like, so what brings you out to LA? You live here? And then I lived in Hemet. I said, yeah, I live here. Okay, what do you do?
Like an intern.
I'm a photographer. All these were lies. Oh, that's so good, because I'm looking for a photographer. I have a stand-up show Tuesday nights at Laugh Factory, and I need a photographer. And I'm like, oh, well, I'm your girl. Okay, you know how to take photos without a flash, because we can't use
2 weeks.
Uh-huh. And I'm like, I have no idea. I just lied through this whole thing. I go home, I'm asking people, I'm looking up online how to do it. I figure it out, and that Tuesday I go back to Laugh Factory. And, you know, and so I was doing that for a while. I
thought it was an issue.
A couple of months.
I never thought, like
back then, the big thing for us comics, it was MySpace.
But I knew,
and we wanted our profile picture to be us on stage with one of the big names behind us, Laugh Factory. Were you the one taking all those shots at Laugh Factory?
Some of them, yeah.
Chris had one first out of all of us. And I remember Rusty Dooley's was, and they were all at Jake's Club.
Yeah, so I did Tuesday nights, and not every Tuesday night, but a lot of them. And he had like two other girls, I want to say. And so when one of us couldn't do it, the other one showed up. So I was one of them. And so I did that show. And then along the way, I started meeting other comics that were like, hey, you know, can you take my photo or my headshots, you know, or can you come to improv with me, or the haha. And so so around that time I had met someone who had a local TV show called Comedy Report that they wanted to do, and they said, you know, you're here all the time, you know comics, I really want you to host the show. And then the guy gives me a list and says, okay, you're gonna interview Eric Schwartz and Chris D'Elia. And I'm like, I felt okay, like I have no idea who these people are. So I'm looking Chris D'Elia, and he's like, oh, that's me. I'm like, oh, okay. So I'm going to interview you. And so we did this, but the camera guy didn't show up. He got, something happened. He ended up not coming. So we just all like went to dinner at Mel's after and hung out, and I became friends with them. And so then I think it was Chris that said, can you come to HaHa with me and take some photos of me on stage? And I'm like, sure. And then that's when I met you. So you guys were already friends at that point, but it was probably all at the same time.
No, I'm not. Remember the show? It was
Phil Verone's show.
Phil Verone. Yes, I remember.
End up in rock and roll.
Yeah,
because he was the drummer for Skid Row.
It wasn't even an issue. Yeah, I just decided to do it.
Yeah, and I did a lot of his photography for his events and stuff. Like, it just is. It's crazy how it all kind of snowballed for me too, off of a lie. Like one night, it was one night of me
doing it. Calling it a lie, let's call it a hustle.
Well, a hustle. So we both hustled.
Wow.
And kind of faked it till we made it, but it worked out really great. I think for both of us, my photography career was pretty crazy. I mean, I from there ended up, it's just kind of like connections, you know? And so then I met people and they said, you know, Playboy is looking for an event photographer, so then I ended up working at Playboy for a few years doing their event photography.
And I saved, I lived like I was.
Yeah, like you and I did that.
I see that money growing, but I didn't touch it. Still, to this day, I'm like, I am saving it.
We did that.
The YouTube skit, yeah, the sketch comedy thing.
And then that led to other things, and so like, it's funny how it just kind of all
like 100%.
The difference here's what happened, and this is why you apartment. Kept going, because you kept showing up.
My first time getting gas and electric. People, in my
the first
name,
time is
like,
hard, or the second time is hard, they're like, okay, that's enough. I'm guilty of that in a lot of ways. Like, I never got into ski because the first time I ever skied, I wasn't good at it, so I never wanted to.
It's a having.
But with this, it's literally like my dad used to tell people, in martial arts when they would have a hard time in class and they weren't doing well and everything like that. And they're like, what am I going to do? And my dad said, the secret to this is so simple. Just show up to your next class.
Everything will come right.
And that's what I did. I just showed up to the next show. And even if I wasn't on the show, the next night I was in the room.
From the accident,
yep. Showing up.
Right. Well, that's the thing too, and it became addicting to me because I'm from a small town.
Question. You know what? I, through the years of training, I've had a couple of things happen. I was training with another trainer, and we were going pretty hard, and I hurt my back. And I was out for 10 months where I couldn't even basically stand up. I have herniated discs in my L4, 5, and sacrum and a narrowing of the spine. And I would collapse in the shower sometimes because my leg would just go numb and I'd fall. I couldn't hold a 10-pound weight. And so 10 months, I basically was on my back. And thank God for the clients I have because it would take everything in me to drive to them, and then I would get to them and lay on the floor and I would tell them what to do. It was but it's
I still got it done.
I didn't miss a day of work. You know, because of the accident, if you look at my spine in an x-ray, it's completely sideways, my head is on crooked, like nothing is normal. And so the doctors just said it was just a matter of time with you deadlifting and lifting the way that you do with your spine the way it is. It was just a matter of time before something, you know, snapped. So I did get over that. Last year I was diagnosed with diverticulitis, and that's just basically a pocket in my intestines where food gets stuck and it creates infections. So I had two infections last year, but I've been feeling really good, so I haven't had any issues in a while. So I just have to be really careful about what I eat. So I've done a lot of studying on nutrition and everything, and just staying away from the things that I've learned my body doesn't like, and then just so I have to be like really strict with that. But yeah, I mean, for the most part, everything is good. I've been able to pretty much do everything. I was running marathons, but since my back injury, I've had to stop that. But I will say, before we leave my marathon story, one of my clients lost 150 pounds and he said, I want to do a marathon. And I said, okay, great. And he was like, it's in 3 months. And I'm like, oh, I don't think, I mean, we could try it, but do you want to do like a half or something first? He's like, nope. All or nothing, and you're doing it with me. And I'm like, what? I haven't ran more than 5 miles in my entire life.
This is after the back injury. This is after the back injury.
Before.
All right, got you.
Yeah, and so I trained him. I didn't train at all. I didn't take it seriously, to be honest. I'm like, there's no way this kid is finishing a full marathon. Like, he's still got a lot of work to do, so I just have to keep up with him. So I'm fine. I worked legs the day before the marathon. I did not take this serious at all. Did not run not 1 mile. Day of, I meet him, I'm like, oh, like it's like 4 or 5 in the morning, so it's still dark out, my legs are sore from my workout the day before. I'm like, that probably wasn't smart. We go through that first 13 miles and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is the longest I've ever ran in my life. And it wasn't that hard because you have like the energy of the crowd. Yeah. And then we hit mile 17 and I hit a wall and I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't know if this is smart. And I see people getting taken away by paramedics and I look at him and I'm like, are you okay? And he's like, yeah, I'm okay. And I'm like, oh my gosh, that could be him. He could be next. I'm like, wait, that could be me. I didn't train at all for this. What am I doing? And
at mile 17, you realize this.
Oh, it's mile 17. I'll never forget. And then I looked at him. I said, I think I need to stop for a second. You want to stop? He's like, yeah, me too. And when we stopped, it was like a truck hit me. And I'm like, I can't stop. And he's like, oh, I can't either. And we're running in place. And I'm like, panicked. Like, what am I going to do? It hurts to stop. It hurts to keep going. And I just panicked. Like, how is this going to end? And so I'm like, all right, he's like, we got to finish. I'm like, yeah, we do. So we crossed that finish line and we were crying. We did 26.2 miles without.
Right, you didn't even really, you didn't even train for it.
I didn't train personally at all. He trained, he got up to like, I want to say 10 miles before the marathon. I got to zero. So I couldn't move the next day, but because I did it and I did it with no, I had no desire to ever run a marathon in my life, but, but that proved to me how amazing the body is.
Yes.
And it made me want more. And so I, the next year, the LA Marathon, I actually really tried. And I trained for it, and I cut my time in half, and it was amazing.
Wow.
And and so it really got me going. And then I wanted to do a triathlon because I just kept wanting to push for more. I'm like, okay, if my body could do that. It was just this amazing moment of, wow, your body is capable of so much that we don't give it credit for. But then my back injury happened, and I couldn't run the, I can do the try, but it was another thing in my life, you know, with the accident, with overcoming, you know, my abusive relationship, and then, you know, being homeless for a little bit, and then the whole marathon and everything. It's like, things happen in your life that make you see how strong you are mentally and physically. And we just don't get enough credit. And like I said earlier, it would be so easy for you or me to become a victim and use that as an excuse and blame other people. But I'm so glad we didn't.
No doubt. And then we continue to plant these seeds. So we're on a crusade now. You just inspired me. Thank you.
You inspired me. Thank you so much. Yeah,
we will, and we will meet for sure. We definitely will meet. Yep.
We will.
Thank you.
We will. Thank you so much, Lewis. Thank you. Yep. We'll have you on here again, I'm sure. We'll do something.
There it is. And then what we'll do is, like, as we grow and as we do what we do, we come back and revisit, and it's, we always remain the same. It's all about planting positive seeds. Like, that's all it's about. So I appreciate you. Much love, and I'll be in touch.
Thank you so much. Love to you too.